Good morning, students. We'll continue with the chapter Indigo. We had done a brief introduction yesterday. And before I start with the reading of the chapter, there are a few things that I want to remind you once again about the setting, about the backdrop of this chapter. What is important thing that was the problem that was there among the peasants, which led to this struggle or which led to this movement, which became, as I said, it was the base or it was a trigger for our movement or for our struggle for independence, right? And when the peasants were involved, when people at the grassroots are involved, when everyone is ready to stand up, that is when any movement, when any change, it becomes really successful. So before we begin, I want you to just remember once again, what is the system that is being discussed here? It is sharecropping. What is sharecropping? The Britishers, they had a very long-term agreement with the peasants. And under that agreement, the peasants, they had to grow a commercial crop on their land. The Britishers, they were the landlords. Who were the tenants? The peasants were the tenants, Indian peasants. And yes, apart from the seasonal crops, they were made to grow a commercial crop. That was on 15% of their land, right? And that crop they had to pay or they had to give over to the Britishers. It was a commercial crop and so they had to give it over to the Britishers. And during this time, which crop was there? Indigo was there, right? Now, what had happened was, Germany had developed synthetic indigo. Synthetic indigo, much cheaper, much readily available than the natural one. And of course, throughout the year, it would be available. So what happened was, the peasants, when they came to know about this, they wanted to stop growing indigo. Because who's going to buy it then? And right, what is the purpose of growing it when it is not required? Right? So they wanted to come out of this agreement. They wanted to stop growing that commercial crop. And also they wanted to be released from the system of sharecropping. Now what happened when the peasants started raising their voices against this problem? The Britishers, they did not want the peasants to stop that, right? They wanted, in fact, that the peasants should pay them compensation for coming out of this system. The peasants raised their voice. The Britishers, they called the lawyers and the thugs, and many of the peasants, they signed, right, on the agreement that, yes, they will pay compensation to be released. Many of them did not. So this was this big situation of turmoil when Gandhi arrived at Champaran. So Champaran, a remote district near the foothills of Nepal. It's part of Bihar, right? That is where this agitation of the peasants, it began. Is this clear? Right? So we are talking about how Mahatma Gandhi helped the peasants, how he helped them to come out of this system of right injustice. And with that political movement, there were so many other changes that were brought about in the lives of the peasants. So one step, it can bring about so many changes in one life. It also brought Mahatma Gandhi more closer to the peasants. He got a very clear picture of what is happening in the various parts of the country. And yes, so he was there leading this struggle from the front. This is the story about Rajkumar Shukla, an illiterate peasant, but brave, courageous, determined. He wanted to do something for not only himself, but for others. And he had the courage to stand up against this system, right? So we'll, as I read, as we discuss this chapter, you people will learn more about this struggle, right? Or this movement, okay? Right. Wait, let me just admit those students who are there. And right, that's nice. She on her own, I think so. Please, students, join the class on time. I think so, even from the comfort of your home, we still get late. So please make sure that you try to wake up on time and join on time. Okay. Yes, so those who have joined late, we're doing chapter Indigo. We have discussed, or maybe just had a brief recap. Right, so let's have a look at this. So can you see the screen? Is it visible? Yes, it is. Right, so let's start with the reading here. Any doubts, any questions? You can ask me about it, right? When I first visited Gandhi in 1942 at his ashram in Sevagram in central India, he said, I will tell you how it happened that I decided to urge the departure of the British. It was in 1917. This chapter has been written by Louis Fisher, right? And he was greatly impressed by the work of Mahatma Gandhi, and he has written this book about Mahatma Gandhi, right? And so he's telling about his meeting with him and how he started, you know, really getting involved in the struggle for independence. And how it actually began, it was in 1917, right? So I visited Gandhi in 1942. Who is I over here? I is Louis Fisher, the writer, okay? He had gone to the December 1916 annual convention. So who's telling the story? Yes, Mahatma Gandhi, right? Gandhiji is telling about his story and how the struggle began. He had gone to the December 1916 annual convention of the Indian National Congress Party in Lucknow. There were 2,301 delegates and many visitors. During the proceedings, Gandhi recounted, a peasant came up to me looking like any other peasant in India, poor and emaciated, weak. Because, as we've discussed, the condition of the peasants was not very good, right? And here, in spite of toiling so hard in the fields, they were not getting the fruit of their labor, right? So they were not getting that due justice or the due, you can say, for the hard work that they, due recognition, okay? So a peasant came and said, I am Rajkumar Shukla. I am from Champaran, sorry, and I want you to come to my district. Gandhi had never heard of the place. It was in the foothills of the towering Himalayas near the kingdom of Nepal. So the farmer, who was the farmer, Rajkumar Shukla, and he was very weak, very poor, and he came to Mahatma Gandhi. He had gone for this convention over there at Lucknow, and he had heard about the work he's done, and he's requested him, so please come to Champaran. Gandhi had never heard of that place. It was a small district over there in the foothills of the Himalayas near the kingdom of Nepal. Under an ancient arrangement, the Champaran peasants were sharecroppers. So it was an old agreement between the Britishers and the peasants. And these peasants, they were sharecroppers. I have just discussed now what sharecropping is, right? Rajkumar Shukla was one of them. So he was under this agreement of sharecropping. He was illiterate but resolute. But what was different about him, what made him stand out from the other farmers, even though he was illiterate, but he was resolute, he was determined. I want to change the system. He had come to the Congress session to complain about the injustice of the land law system in Bihar, and somebody had probably said, speak to Gandhi. Gandhi told Shukla he had an appointment in Kanpur, right? And was also committed to go to other parts of India. Shukla accompanied him everywhere. And Shukla wanted him. He said, you please come with me to Champaran. And so he was with Gandhi. Wherever Gandhi went, he was accompanying him. Then Gandhi returned to his ashram near Ahmedabad. So when he had gone for the convention to Lucknow, when he went to Kanpur, Kanpur, see the old spelling. And right, then when Gandhi returned to Ahmedabad, Shukla followed him to the ashram. For weeks, he never left Gandhi's side. That means he had so much of faith in Gandhi that only you can do something for the welfare of the peasants. He was following him everywhere. Fix a date, he begged. Impressed by the sharecropper's tenacity and story, Gandhi said, I have to be in Kolkata on such and such a date. Come and meet me and take me from there. So he's really impressed. Look at this man. He is not giving up. Tenacious to hold on to. Right? The courage, you know, like the determination that he had. I want to stop the system. And he's following Gandhi everywhere. I have to be in Kolkata. Right? So come and meet me and take me from there. So Gandhi, you know, like in a way, he's quite sure this man is not going to turn up. So he's saying, I'm going to Kolkata this time. And you come over there. Then you take me to your district. You take me to your place. And I'll see to it. So he's not positive that this farmer will turn up. Months passed. Shukla was sitting on his haunches at the appointed spot in Kolkata when Gandhi arrived. He waited till Gandhi was free. And to his surprise, Shukla was already there. He was sitting on his haunches, on his feet, right? Sitting there waiting for him at the station. Then the two of them boarded a train for the city of Patna in Bihar. So he is there from Kolkata. They've gone to Patna, Bihar, capital. There Shukla led him to the house of a lawyer named Rajendra Prasad, who later became president of the Congress Party and of India, right? So he later on became the president of India, Rajendra Prasad. So where did they go? From Kolkata to Patna. And where in Patna? To Rajendra Prasad's house, who was a lawyer. Rajendra Prasad was out of town, but the servants knew Shukla as a poor yeoman who pestered their master to help the indigo sharecroppers. So although Rajendra Prasad was not there, Shukla was quite a common figure at that place, right? So the workers, the people there, they knew about him because he would regularly go to that place and request people to help him. Rajendra Prasad was a lawyer. He needed the lawyer's help. So they let him stay on the grounds with his companion, Gandhi, whom they took to be another peasant. So they thought that Gandhi was also another peasant. Why do you think so? Why did you think that Gandhi was another peasant? Because he was with Shukla? Because Shukla was always coming and complaining and always asking people to help him? Or it could be, yes, because of Gandhi's simple sense of dressing, right? So yes, so they thought that he is also his companion. So they let him stay on the grounds with his companion Gandhi, whom they took to be another peasant. But Gandhi was not permitted to draw water from the well, lest some drops from his bucket pollute the entire source. How did they know that he was not an untouchable? So see, the practice of untouchability was also there. So the people there were considered low caste. How inhuman, right? They were not allowed to draw water from the common well. In case that water touched them or, you know, like, and it polluted them. Can anybody even think like that? How inhuman could such a practice be? So they thought that, see, Gandhi is also with him. And so he was not allowed to draw water in case that he was an untouchable, right? So can we look at these questions here? Yes, all of you. Come on, look at your books, please. And let us go through these questions on the side here. Let's go to the comprehension questions and let me see how many of you are actually listening to me. Yes, strike out what is not true in the following. Let me get your answers. Rajkumar Shukla was a sharecropper, a politician, a delegate, a landlord. Who was Rajkumar Shukla? Yes, options are there. Can I have answers? Can I have the answers? What was he? He was a... What's the correct answer? Was he a landlord? No, he was not a landlord. Okay, Mankirat is there with us. Nice. Good. And Jasdev has also joined us today. Great. So, yes, give me the answer then. Mankita, are you listening? Aditya, Harsimar? Anybody? He was a sharecropper. Very good, Tanisha, Shivam, and thank you for your answer. Next is Shukla. Rajkumar Shukla was poor. Was he physically strong? Was he illiterate? Yes. What is not true? He was not physically strong. He was poor. He was, he was an illiterate farmer. An illiterate sharecropper. Let's be precise. Why is Rajkumar Shukla described as being resolute? Resolute, determined. Why has he been described as being determined? Because he went directly to Gandhi at the Lucknow Convention, followed him everywhere. And after many months, when he asked him to reach a particular place, and he was there at the appointed place. So he was very determined because he wanted the farmers' condition to change. He wanted the sharecropping system to be removed. Why do you think the servants sought Gandhi to be another peasant? Yes, because he was with Rajkumar Shukla. Is it? Okay. Yeah. Did you get the answers? Let's continue. Gandhi decided to go first to Muzaffarpur, which was en route to Champaran. So now they have gone to Patna. And now what is the next stop going to be? What is it going to be? Yes, so what is it going to be? It is going to be Champaran. But en route to Champaran, where are they going to go to? Muzaffarpur. To obtain more complete information about conditions and Shukla was capable of imparting. So although Shukla has given Mahatma Gandhi information, he wanted complete information that what is the agreement? What is the system about? He accordingly sent a telegram to Professor J.B. Kriplani of the Arts College in Muzaffarpur, whom he had seen at Tagore's Shanti Niketan School. The train arrived at midnight, 15 April 1917. See? Here and right, so names which we are reading, they are familiar later on. Yeah, all leaders and part of the independence struggle. Kriplani was waiting at the station with a large body of students. Gandhi stayed there for 2 days in the home of Professor Malkani, a teacher in a government school. It was an extraordinary thing in those days, Gandhi commented, for a government professor to harbor a man like me. In smaller localities, the Indians were afraid to show sympathy for advocates of home rule. So people were not given shelter in the homes. Why? Because of inviting the anger of the Britishers. And Gandhi was known there. Yes, so he was a leader. And any association with him would have brought problem to the professor. Right? So people were not welcoming these people for fear of the British, right? To show sympathy for advocates of home rule, people who were raising their voice for home rule, that is our rule. The people should get the rule back in their own country. The news of Gandhi's advent and the nature of his mission spread quickly through Muzaffarpur and to Champaran. Sharecroppers from Champaran began arriving on arriving on foot and by conveyance to see their champion. Who was their champion? Gandhi, because he's going to fight for their cause. They had lots of hopes and expectations. Muzaffarpur lawyers called on Gandhi to brief him. They frequently represented peasant groups in court. They told him about their cases and reported the size of their fee. Now see, the lawyers, they met Gandhi. They told him that, yeah, we represent the groups in court. And they told him, yeah, we don't do it for free. We need, they tell them about the fee that they charge. Gandhi chided the lawyers for collecting big fee from the sharecroppers. He was annoyed at them that how can you charge so much of money from these sharecroppers? Already they are there under such miserable conditions and you are charging money from them? He said, I have come to the conclusion that we should stop going to law courts. Taking such cases to the courts does little good. where the peasants are so crushed and fear-stricken law courts are useless. The real relief for them is to be free from fear. Beautiful lines. He said, what is the use of such lawyers? When you're charging so much of fee, you have already created a fear in the mind, right? And how the lawyers are behaving. When the peasants wanted release from that agreement, the lawyers were forcing them to sign that agreement and to give a compensation to being released. And Gandhi is saying that where the people are not free, where they can't go to lawyers without freedom in their mind, without any fear, what purpose are they going to solve, right? So he thinks that law courts are useless. He's angry at the lawyers. How can you behave like this? How can you charge so much money? How are you creating so much of fear in the minds of the peasants, right? Most of the arable land in the Champaran district was divided into large estates owned by Englishmen and worked by tenants. Arable land, which is for cultivation, and it was owned by Englishmen, the estates, and who did the work over there? The Indian tenants, the Indian peasants. The chief commercial crop was indigo. The landlords compelled all tenants to plant 3/20 or 15% of their holdings with indigo and surrender the entire indigo harvester's rent. This was done by long-term contract. So we discussed the system of sharecropping. What was it? Yes, that the peasants, they had to grow indigo. That was a commercial crop. 15% of the land holdings and the produce, because it was commercial, it was paid over, or you can say as rent, it was given to the landlords. And it's a long-term contract, a long-term agreement. Since so many years, it was going on. Presently, the landlords learned that Germany had developed synthetic indigo. They thereupon obtained agreements from the sharecroppers to pay them compensation for being released from the 15% arrangement. So now when synthetic indigo is there, who's going to need this indigo? So they wanted to be released from this system. We don't want to grow indigo anymore. The sharecropping arrangement was irksome to the peasants and many signed willingly. So many of them, yes, we want to be released. Those who resisted, engaged lawyers, the landlords hired thugs. So everybody has to sign what? That they are going to give compensation for being released from the system, right? Which is totally unjust. Meanwhile, the information about synthetic indigo reached the illiterate peasants who had signed, and they wanted their money back. And with great difficulty, they must have collected that amount, or yes, how they must have paid that money to be released from that system. And now they know that the whole time, why was this, why were they allowing them to sign? And why are they asking for compensation? Because synthetic indigo is available in the market. The peasants realized their mistake, and now they want their money back. And they're not getting the money back. The lawyers, the thugs, hand in glove with the tenant, the landlords, the Britishers. So it is a very, a very scary situation here, or it is a very confronting situation between the peasants and the landlords, right? And who is creating that fear? The lawyers, the thugs, are forcing the peasants to sign. At this point, Gandhi arrived in Champaran. So, and this confrontation was going on between the peasants and the landlords, and it was at this time that Gandhi reached Champaran. Okay? Yes. So I'll just stop here for the day, and I'll ask you a few more questions before we wind up.